This is the second part of veno-arterial ECMO complication and the troubleshooting. When we are managing veno-arterial ECMO complication or troubleshooting, it's like a puzzle. We should put each data beside each other to be able to interpret it very well. The first complication we should discuss is inadequate oxygenation. And that means that oxygen saturation in the drainage cannula is less than 70% with increasing lactate, with or without SpO2 saturation from the patient side less than 92%. Before judging that, we should state that or confirming that if IO2 from ECMO side 100% and the patient had the full ECMO flow. Adequate oxygenation means that oxygen saturation from the drainage cannula less than 70%, and that can be read from the console side. But if the oxygen saturation from the patient more than 92, that means the patient is anemic. We can transfuse blood, increase oxygen consumption, so we can use sedation or neuromuscular blockade. The ECMO flow is low, we can increase the ECMO flow. But if the patient oxygen saturation less than 92%, that may be differential hypoxemia or gas failure device or oxygenator failure. And now we will start with differential hypoxemia. Differential hypoxemia, it's named Northrop syndrome or Harlequin syndrome. When it happens, if the patient is present or we put the patient on VA ECMO and the patient has pulmonary disease. So VA ECMO peripherally and pulmonary disease. And pulmonary disease like ARDS, cardiogenic pulmonary edema. So when it will happen, when the heart started to recover and has increasing in stroke volume, that is reflected by increased pulse pressure, and the heart and the lung is still diseased with presence of intrapulmonary shunt or VQ mismatch, that will lead to differential hypoxemia. The upper part will be blue and the lower part will be red. This is meant by differential hypoxemia. More details in the next slides. In this diagram, it's explained very simply how the differential hypoxemia happened. First, the blood not ejecting, so there is no differential hypoxemia. On the starting of ejecting blood, every time the mixing cloud which appear here will go down and more differential hypoxemia will happen when the heart starts to eject with presence of unhealthy lung. And we can see every time the heart will eject, the mixing cloud will go down. Here another demonstration for Harlequin syndrome or South syndrome, where the ejecting heart started to eject more for the blood. So the deoxygenated blood will go to the brain. So the upper part of the body will be deoxygenated and the lower part of the body become oxygenated blood. And this is a problem. The brain will not have enough oxygen in this case. In this simplified diagram, which is showing interaction between the patient's native heart and the VA ECMO flow. In the first part, on upper part of the diagram, we show that the heart started to eject. So the brain will be affected by the oxygenated blood. Besides the high flow of ECMO, there will be stasis in the heart, and that will be reflected by increased risk of stroke. So the brain will be affected in two ways, by increased risk of stroke from the stasis and the effect of deoxygenated blood. In the second part of the diagram, we will show that the heart starts more ejecting and that also the brain is affected by deoxygenated blood, but the level of stroke will decrease. And we should note that in patients with a high flow of ECMO, we should be sure that we are giving anticoagulation to maintain or decrease the risk of stroke. How to prevent differential hypoxemia? First, pulmonary intervention. We can use ultra-protective ventilation and that lead to help the lung to recover. The second thing, in the shunt, decrease the shunt or VQ mismatch, ventilation-perfusion mismatch. that occur by increasing PEEP or positive end expiratory pressure, which will increase mean airway pressure using diuresis and trying to lead the patient toward the negative balance, suctioning the secretion from the lung. How can we detect differential hypoxemia? First, any hypoxic patient on ECMO, we should confirm that this ECMO circuit is connected to gas resource. Second thing, FiO2 from ECMO site should be maintained 100%, then titrated the FiO2 to avoid hyperoxia. We should monitor SpO2 in the lower limb to be sure that SpO2 more than 90%, and right upper limb should be monitored as it reflects the native heart function and the lung function. Also, the arterial tube monitoring should be bright red. There is color differentiation between the arterial and venous tubes. How can we solve differential hypoxemia? If the cardiac function still require ECMO, we have good lung, oxygen saturation more than 90%, we will continue via ECMO. If the lung is affected and oxygen saturation less than 90%, we will continue via ECMO with the following, like we can move arterial cannula to the upper limb or shift the patient to central VA ECMO, or increase the drainage oxygen saturation by advancing the drainage cannula or transition to VVA or VAV. The second issue, if the patient not required ECMO and the lung is not healthy and SpO2 less than 92%, so we will shift it to VVA ECMO. If the lung is not affected and the saturation is more than 92%, we will go for decannulation. When we have differential hypoxemia, we will go for cannula configuration if the patient still needed an ECMO and the lung is affected. So we can increase mixed oxygen saturation by decrease the effect of intrapulmonary shunt. And that will happen by divert oxygenated blood from ECMO to right atrial duct. How can we do that? By using VAV configuration. The drainage cannula will be in femoral vein as usual, and the return cannula won't be in femoral artery as it's peripheral peripheral VA ECMO, and we will add another one in the upper part of the body in the right internal jugular, another return cannula. Another method to resolve differential hypoxemia is advanced drainage cannula into severe vena cava. And we should note that severe vena cava has lower SpO2 than inferior vena cava, and there is difference in oxygen extraction between upper and lower part of the body. So when we take the blood from severe vena cava into the ECMO, the part which will stay in the heart is from inferior vena cava. It will be more oxygenated blood, so the heart will eject more oxygenated blood to the upper body. The third solution of our problem from cannula configuration is use VVA configuration. And that means we will use two drainage cannula, one be in femoral vein, extend to the junction between right atrium and inferior vena cava junction, and the second one will be in internal jugular vein. The return cannula will be in the femoral artery, extend to distal aorta at this, so peripheral VA ECMO. It's one in the femoral vein and the other part in the femoral artery, but we will add another drainage cannula in the right internal jugular vein. So very simple difference between VAV or VVA. In VAV, we will add another return in internal jugular, but in VVA, we will add another drainage in the right internal jugular vein. Both of them in right internal jugular vein, but in VVA, it will be return cannula, but in VVA, it will be drainage cannula. Reverse differential hypoxemia. Abdominal organ and lower limb hypoxemia is detected, especially when the cardiac function improves. We had a normal lung, but the oxygen saturation from in the return cannula is very low. Right upper limb is supplied by native heart with good lung function, and the lower limb oxygen saturation should be monitored as supplied by the ECMO. This is happen when we weaning ECMO and decrease the flow and decrease oxygen saturation from ECMO, FiO2 and ECMO side. All of these can cause abdominal organ and lower limb hypoxemia. Then we will go for the another cause of inadequate oxygenation, which is gas failure device or oxygenator failure. Gas failure device or oxygenator failure, it can be caused by sweep gas interruption or intrinsic membrane failure. Both of them can lead to a loss of differentiation of the color between drainage and return cannulas. And we will start with sweep gas interruption as a cause of gas failure device. Sweep gas interruption is a very important cause of hypoxemia or hypercapnia. We should check for it in the first part of any algorithm. It may be due to disconnection from the source or kinking in the tube, empty oxygen tank. How can we differentiate? It will happen within minutes. There is normal delta P, which is the difference between B2 minus B1. No clot detected in the oxygenator. How can we solve re-establish connection with the gas source? Then we will go for intrinsic membrane failure, the cause of gas failure device. Intrinsic membrane failure from blood side, there will be just clots or fibrin built up. Happen within days, there is increase in delta B, which is B2 minus B3. Larger clots present in the oxygenator, there is an adequate transfer of gas. Presence with or without hemolysis, this is inside from blood side. From gas side, there is condensation of the gas, rupture of the membrane, plasma leakage, fiber obstruction. All these will happen within days. Normal delta B, detection of small clots in the oxygenator, inadequate transfer of gas. All of this means we should change the circuit if the oxygenator and pump are the one unit, or change the oxygenator by itself if the oxygenator is a single alone or a single unit. To diagnose oxygenator failure, we should do a pre and post membrane arterial blood gas, while the FiO2 from ECMO side 100%, sweep gas more than 2 liter, and the flow sweep gas ratio 1 to 2. If a post membrane PO2 divided by FiO2 from ECMO side less than 150 means there is impending oxygenator failure, and is it change not that urgent, but it should be done within days. The normal ratio is 300 to 500. If it's less than 100, there is urgent change. Post membrane is PO2, maybe 100% in a failing oxygenator. So we should check pre and post membrane arterial blood gas. We should be sure that inadequate oxygenation, not related to excess of rated flow, and the definition of rated flow is present in the lecture of ECMO physiology. Another form of oxygenator failure or intrinsic membrane failure is inadequate removal of CO2. And it can be diagnosed by using high sweep gas pre and post membrane with CO2 is unchanged. So it can be diagnosed when we use high sweep gas and the lung is recovered, but we are unable to wean the sweep gas. Sometimes when we use a sink with a flow 10 liter for 5 to 30 seconds, this will flush the condensate gas inside the membrane. And we should know that membrane failure can be represented by hypoxia or hypercarbia or both of them. If we have cardiac arrest while we are in VA ECMO, and the cardiac arrest because of stop of ECMO flow at that time, there is no perfusing heart rhythm, we will start CPR. As usual CPR, starting chest compression, rule out pneumothorax and precardial tamponade till we resuming the ECMO flow, and reinitiate and titrate the inotropes. If the cardiac arrest due to a ventricular VTAC, ventricular tachycardia, pulses ventricular tachycardia, or ventricular fibrillation, So we can use defibrillator and antiarrhythmogenic drugs to treat this cardiac arrest. If the cardiac arrest due to an inadequate ECMO perfusion and the ECMO flow is set at the goal, at its goal, there is no need for achieving chest compression, but we will ensure that we increasing the vasopressors to achieve target MAP, as native heart will provide 20% from cardiac output. Also, if there is pulses electrical activity, we should check for 4H and 4T for cardiac CBR, and it should be corrected as long as ECMO flow isn't at its goal. Besides the references in this lecture, I depend on also read book, and also Jeff and videos are taken by me. Thank you, and you can post your questions in the comments.